Hello and welcome to session 186 in the AISafety.com reading group. Tonight we will be discussing the article Measuring the Algorithmic Efficiency of Neural Networks by Danny Hernandez and Tom Brown. Danny Hernandez is the corresponding author, the lead researcher on this particular project. There was some help by Tom B. Brown, but Danny is definitely the primary. Both of them are at the foresight part division of OpenAI. There's both a research paper, which is the one that I'm basing this presentation on, and there's a corresponding blog post, which is somewhat broader than the actual research, and which I also recommend you to read. This is quite new also, less than a month old, and there's also a podcast with where Danny Hernandez is a guest at the 80,000 Hours podcast. I haven't actually gone around to hear it yet, but I presume that's probably quite interesting as well. So, the idea is that one part of, we are seeing a lot of progress in AI right now, and efficiency is almost certainly a big part of it. And the reason we care so much about what is the progress in AI historically is because we want to forecast this into the future, and being able to have a decent grounding in what is the current trends is probably quite valuable. We've seen previously in the AI and compute that that's actually quite a while ago that the total amount of compute available to the largest AI projects that grew with an enormous factor, 300,000 between 2012 and 2008. They choose here between 2012 and 2018, and of course this analysis also looks at this particular interval, and it's not a randomly chosen interval. It's sometimes being called the deep learning revolution. So I expect, but can't actually prove, that choosing a different starting point would give much slower rates of growth. So why did the compute increase so much? Well, there's of course more investments, and also because the hardware parts grew somewhat. That can be quantified, but what we can observe is what was the overall cost of training, and the big part of this is the training efficiency. We don't care very much about how expensive the generated neural nets are at actually doing inference, at actually working. We care only about the training efficiency because it basically dominates the inference efficiency. And this training cost has several components. We have the trends in training costs reflects the trends that are just Moore's law, basically. Here, they're just saying Moore's law, well, that's just double performance every 18 months, and I think that's a rather weak. You have the actual TPUs, and you can actually measure those, and I think it would be possible to get a much clearer and much more detailed analysis than just saying, oh well, a doubling every 18 months. So that's a possibility for further work. Then cloud computing has also matured substantially, in particular for neural networks. We have much better hardware utilization, but the fourth factor is the one that we're really interested in, and that is that is the algorithms have improved, and that makes the efficiency we get out of the hardware better. So another way we could look at this is to see the level of investment in AI. We see, for instance, that the Moore's law requires a lot more researchers now than it did back in the 70s. And AI investment in a similar scheme has increased very, very substantially. And this is both in compute and probably also in that more researchers are looking at the algorithms, and that probably reflects in faster progress on the algorithms. Here are some numbers between 2012 and 2018, where the startups increased from 7 to 40 billion, the IPOs and mergers from 5 to 23, and the US government increased also a lot. In total, the investment went up roughly by a factor of 5. So how much more have the algorithms, how should we think about increases in algorithmic efficiency? We can go to the classic field of algorithms, where we see the quality of, say, a sorting algorithm depends on asymptotically bounded increases according to with how much the cost increases according to how much the problem size increases. This is often shown with what is called the big O notation. And so for AI algorithms, we don't have anything like that at all. The way we normally see improvements in algorithm quality being reported is new states of the art that now we can solve this problem, and nothing basically about the cost. And that's really bad for several reasons. The first reason is that when we have the when we do have performance measurements, they are in different units. There's no really standardized way of reporting this. The metrics that we get are hard to interpret, right? If one person say, we can solve this problem in translation, and the other person say, we can solve this in Go, and a third person do have a result in image classifications, then it's really hard to merge them together in any way. And of course, there's more focus on what we can do than how much it costs. And finally, when someone do propose a benchmark, usually they propose a benchmark that they can either reach now or reach very soon. So it's hard to see the long-term picture if the benchmarks are reached within a year every time. Now, there are a couple of other fields where people have tried to measure the rate of improvements on efficiency. The first is linear programming, which is stated to have been of commercial interest for a long period. Actually, it was a military project in the beginning, but it's basically been actively researched for a long time. And what we've seen is a doubling in speed every 13 months, and that's been consistent for 21 years. I mean, you probably can't see the graph here very much, but it's really surprisingly consistent. And this is also a very well understood problem, and the progress is also well understood. Danny Hernandez wants us to put too much weight on this, because it's done. This analysis is done by the people who actually produce linear programming tools, and so that's a reason why they might be too optimistic. On the other hand, they kept the low performance somewhat artificially, so they might actually also, for that reason, be understating the actual growth. And another image is ResNet 50. Here is it's a Microsoft project, deep residual learning for image recognition. That's been benchmarked on image classification, and the algorithms have improved to the extent that you've gotten 184 time reduction in dollar cost to get this level of performance since 2017. So that was the existing. Now for the actual work by Danny Hernandez. This is based on open source re-implementations of popular models, where he has looked at some of these models and looked what does it take for those to get AlexNet level performance. We are measuring in how many floating point operations per second, rather than looking at memory costs. He's using a module called PyTorch, which have implementation of these models and also have suggested parameters and hyperparameters for them. So the way they are measuring this is having how many floating point operations are required per training image, and then how many images per epoch. This kind of training is often divided into epochs. And then how many epochs do we need to perform as well as AlexNet? Well, these three factors multiplied is the amount of compute that's required. They haven't done much of hyperparameter adjustments between the architectures, only minimal tuning, and that's mostly because the implementation by PyTorch, they already have some suggested hyperparameters, and Danny Hernandez was unable to improve on those. There were some problems, some technical problems with this, and they were mostly overcome. Here I would probably worry quite a bit, because this a number of these models have never been implemented in Python, there is I looked it up. It's called Preapsting's law, that says that improvements to compiler technology double the performance of typical programs every 18 years. And we imagine, in particular for something like PyTorch, we imagine that actually, even if you have precisely the same program, then better memory allocation problems, algorithms would increase performance without any change of the source code at all. So I think this could potentially be a major confounding factor. So what are the actual results when he tries to run the different models? Well, you can see here we have AlexNet from 2012, which required this amount of compute to obtain AlexNet level performance. Then there are a number of others. The ones that are faded here, like VGG11, it's because they were not state of the art. Basically, they were dominated by other algorithms. Here we have GoogleNet with, and then there's a very very clear trend that the amount of compute falls exponentially. This is a logarithmic axis towards 2019. So this graph, the slope of this says that between 2012 and 2019, the amount of compute fell by 44 times. So that's a rather large decrease. That corresponds to a 16-month doubling time. And then there's the following sentence here. Most researchers found the algorithmic efficiency gains to be surprisingly high and regular. And I was confused precisely what was mentioned here. Who are most researchers? I don't expect they interviewed most researchers about this. So one of the things we can they do is they split this up into how efficient are we at learning with the data, and how much does it require to learn from the images. And here you can see AlexNet, if we normalize by AlexNet, saying they had a factor of 1% on number of epochs, and each epoch also took one, and then you multiply these two, you get an efficiency factor. That is, so you can split this up. So for instance, GoogleNet trains with only 1/11th of the number of epochs, but it then needs to train almost twice, almost between 2 and 3 times as long per epoch. Whereas if you go to some of the normals down here, where it's twice as fast here, the efficient net, and it only requires 1/22nd of the data. So these two factors are clearly both important, and they vary quite a bit between architectures. I think here I would have liked to have even more details about this. This is kind of hidden in a small section, and to me the implications of if we have less compute required, that to me implies something like, well, you can get this by just paying twice as much money, then you can get twice as much compute. Whereas something like less data is required, that seems like an improvement that in some way trends towards a something it's been called a reason why we don't really have artificial general intelligence, is that we require much more data. So in that way, I feel these two are quite different, and I would have liked the analysis to split to go deeper into this. So we have it's been observed, of course, that there are some kind of scaling laws with how much compute is required, And this can vary over several orders of magnitude with how much how great efficiency you get, not just to the Alex le net level, but in general. And we can see how this efficiency improves through the scaling laws. This can also help us figure out how much we would need to scale up the older models to get this Alex net level of performance. That was probably not a good explanation, but let me put a graph in here so we can see a bit more. So here we have on the y-axis the image accuracy going from 0 to 100%, and then how much compute we give. Let's start with AlexNet, the blue one here. Starting out with very little compute, it performs really poorly, and then around the 1 teraflop day, there is a discontinuity here where it jumps up a bit to over 75%, and then it increases slowly. And then we can see that some architectures are just better. For instance, we can take here GoogleNet, I think that's ShuffleNet actually, which even for much less compute performs much better and also converges to a higher level. And we can also see something like VG11, which requires much more compute, and only for really large amounts of computes does it actually perform better than AlexNet. So can this kind of analysis be does the same thing happen with other tasks than just image classification? Well, what tasks do we want to look at? We want something where we have it's difficult enough that we can see a large number of improvements over preferably over long time horizons, and we need to have some basically hopefully a re-implementation of open source so we can make this kind of estimates. And we don't really have that for other things, but we can kind of we have some of it for things like translation, which seems to have been improving faster or shorter horizon. We can see if we do instead of image classification then inference on ImageNet, then we get roughly the same amount of progress. If we look at not just AlexNet level but look at ResNet 50 level, then we get a similar rate of progress. And if we look at things like Go or Dota or machine translation, then we see faster levels of efficiency improvements. So where do these efficiency gains actually come from? Well, it's obviously the algorithms getting better. One thing that would in theory be possible would be to try to remove those. So you have instead of just the GoogleNet, then you algorithm implementation, then you have ways to turn off the specific kinds of improvements they make. That would in theory be possible, but a lot of work, so they haven't done that. Instead, they look at what do the authors actually claim improved. So they have batch normalization, residual connections, sparsity, appropriate scaling, architecture search, and all that comes out to 44% efficiency gain. But these numbers are very here it looks like you can just multiply them basically, but they probably do not decompose linearly, and there are probably more things than just saying that oh, GoogleNet has batch normalization is 14 times better, then it means that batch normalization is 14 times 14% reduction. You probably can't do that really. Also, you should note that the authors probably want to emphasize that their new thing is the best thing since sliced bread. So that's also a confounding factor here. There, Danny Hernandez has a I find really interesting discussion between whether we see efficiency gains or whether we are seeing new capabilities. Because normally, progress in AI is defined and talked about in terms of new capabilities. And in this case, when we see it the first time, then that might actually reflect a very, very dramatic reduction in how much compute is required. Often, the first time is, well, basically, we can solve all problems if we just do brute force. But that's of course horribly, horribly inefficient. So often people say that when we get to it a problem becomes solved when we get to a complexity class where it seems to be, you know, feasible to solve, at least in some cases. So in this case, going from a brute force solution to just something quadratic or something like that is probably a really, really astronomical improvement. That's something that I've talked about with the matrix multiplication example as an analogy for progress in machine learning. And improvements in complexity classes do become truly, truly astronomical. And this is the reason why this 44 times might strongly underestimate how much progress that has actually happened. So how much increase has there been in total? Well, the AI and compute trend found a 300,000 improvement. Then we have the efficiency trend of AlexNet, which was 25 times. It was 44 over 2012 to 2019, and only 25 from 2012 to 2018. That's one thing that's also kind of hidden in the paper. So you can basically just multiply that out and get to a 7.5 million times increase in effective training compute between 2012 and 2018. That's a lot. 7.5 million times. I looked up the GDP of Denmark in this period, increased by 0.1%. So that's really a lot. Here you can see the graph again on a logarithmic scale. So this kind of logarithmic scale, I feel, is a bit misleading. It looks like this red is really, really large, and this comparably small. But if you just switched up the factors, so the red one was on the bottom, then this would look very, very different. So the obvious question that we're really interested in is whether this will continue. And basically, Danny Hernandez says he will not discuss this in this paper. That's out of scope. And that's, of course, sad, because that's what we really care about. But this 7.5 million times comes out to a monthly growth of 20%. We have the definition of fast takeoff, which says that 6 months of 12% increase without 24 previous months need to be at most 6% or something like that for the entire economy. That's what people define as a fast improvement, a fast takeoff. And in this case, we can see that if the economy starts to grow at the rate of AI, then in that case, obviously, we would have not just a fast takeoff, but something far beyond that, basically. There are a number of caveat emptor with this. The first is that we need to look into the precise definition of what are the capabilities of interest, and we need to define what does effective compute actually mean. Both of these are described in the paper, and I'm going to skip the first two and instead talk about the reasons why these 25 times could be an overestimate or an underestimate. So what's the reason why it could be an underestimate? Danny Hernandez actually comes out to say he believed that it's likely a substantial underestimate. That's because in this paper, they've chosen, when there's been doubts, they've chosen conservative interpretations. The other algorithms and models are probably optimized for their best performance and not for how well they perform at a much lower level. Their implementation of AlexNet had a better initialization scheme than the original AlexNet, so that would mean that the re-implementation probably used less compute. And then there are gains from there are a number of different things that we talked about previously, and we've also seen other problems where it's faster. Danny Hernandez is open to the claim that efficiency might be a greater factor than increased compute. So most researchers should update in the following way. Here again, he's referring to most researchers, and I don't know what that really means. I feel I've missed something. So if any of you have any ideas about what that means precisely, I am open to hear that. But most researchers should update modestly on faster progress on AI in the short term, and provided this trend continues, then there should be a rather large update on the expectation of progress in the long term. Finally, there are a number of limitations to this analysis, right? There are reasonably few data points, and it focuses only on the final training run cost, and there is of course nothing here about whether this will continue. Well, there is a little, right? Because the 7.5 million, which is the total, then they have measured 1 year more, because well, it's newer than the AI and compute, so they've got one more year, so they can definitely say that it continues from 2018 to 2019, but whether it will continue from that is open. For me, when I read the paper, the thing I was most worried about were these open source re-implementation that I feel have a number of ways they could be biased, either towards lower quality, hindsight. There are many reasons why I could think that they would perform very differently from the original implementations. But I think the overall point stands that we have both hardware and algorithmic efficiency gains. These multiply and they are big. And OpenAI will continue to monitor this in the future. On the blog, they've actually talked about that they will set up some kind of framework. I believe they have set up some kind of framework for monitoring this. And I think that's going to be exciting. And they and I hope that this will be a strong and useful norm in the AI community to report on AI algorithm efficiency improvements. That is all for today. Thank you and see you next week.